was the night of Islander. Things happened on this night 2,000 years ago. A lot of things that we should be rejoicing in, a lot of things we can go longer for. We're going to warm up with a song here.
And carry the cross. words of peace and comfort.
We shall be reassured and strengthened so that fears and anxiety will be overcome by our trust in His love.
As we remember His Last Supper with His disciples in the upper room, us. as we share in the heritage of our faith, remembering the saving drama of Passover and celebrating Jesus' last meal with close friends. Lord Christ, on that night of the Last Supper, you gave your disciples a new commandment, to love one another as you love them. Write this commandment on our hearts. Give us the will to serve others as you are the servant of all, who gave your life and died for us. We praise you, Jesus, for death was not the final answer, but you are alive and reigning with God the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We are invited as disciples to share a last meal with Jesus before we go with our Savior to the cross, before we come in awe to the table of Jesus Christ. Let's take these moments to prepare ourselves for that encounter as we confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. God of mercy and grace, your table is spread before us, and we remember.
We remember the love of your Son, who washed the feet of the one who was about to betray him.
We remember the love of your Son, who broke the bread and whose own body was broken.
We remember the love of your Son, and we cannot bear the reality of our sin.
We are not worthy to be at your table or to be served. Yet your Son welcomes us and serves us.
Forgive us and help us to remember our Savior, who was broken that we might be redeemed.
And Lord, in this time of silence, we continue to confess of our sin to you and to you alone. Rain down your mercy upon us, God our Father, God Holy Spirit, God the Son, be with us. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus welcomed imperfect people to the table. They broke bread with persons of questionable character. We are welcomed at the table, not because we're worthy, but because we are valued, we are forgiven. We are forgiven by God. May the assurance of forgiveness give you a deep peace in your heart. And may the peace of Christ be with you. Let's share the peace with one another.
Thank you. Would you listen now to the Word of God written as we read about the Passover, and then we'll follow that up with the reading of a psalm of gratitude to God for what he's done for you and me. And then we move to the epistle lesson, and the epistle lesson is going to share with you and me the message of what we're going to do tonight when we come to the table of the Lord. And that'll be a piece of special music, and then we will go to our New Testament lesson, the lesson from the Gospel, and we will hear about how Jesus served his disciples and how Jesus wants you and me to serve each other. Listen to the Word of God. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from either the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole gathered congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in all the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. For you this day shall be a day of remembrance. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Through your generations you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." Second lesson, the Psalm of Thanksgiving. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. Death's snares encompass me. The pangs of Sheol lay hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Oh, Lord, I pray, save my life. Or shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift the cup of salvation and call on the Lord's name. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your serving maid. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you a sacrifice of thanksgiving and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord. And into our epistle lesson, familiar words, I suspect. The Apostle Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord, but I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'"
Oh,
Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The word of the Lord. With its several historical connections, the betrayal and arrest of Jesus, the Last Supper, the Passover, Maundy Thursday becomes an occasion on which Christians remember these important events in the life of Jesus and in the history of the nation of Israel. But only remembering does no real justice to these events. They have ongoing present significance for believers like you and me. The Maundy Thursday lessons that we just read go beyond recollection, go beyond simply remembering, also to re-presenting. In the first lesson from the book of Exodus, the notion of re-presenting Passover is clear in those instructions that are given to Israel. And they are elaborate instructions, not simply meant to remind the people of that great event, but to present, even to recreate that great event in each successive generation of Israelites. Now, the Apostle Paul's instructions in 1 Corinthians regarding the Lord's Supper, regarding communion, regarding the Eucharist, are not simply to remind. They urge a similar connection between present community, the Church of Jesus Christ here and now, and a past event. As he saw that the Corinthians ate the meal back then and there in such a way that they failed to acknowledge its connection to the death of Jesus. But the meal itself was and is a proclamation of that death. Now, although John's story of Jesus washing the feet of the disciples typically finds not a whole heck of a lot of support in the liturgy in churches today, although some churches do in fact have a foot washing. If we were to announce what was going to happen tonight ahead of time, I suspect we wouldn't have as many people as we have right now. I've always thought, you know, maybe there's a 21st century equivalent to foot washing. So I haven't come up with what it might be. You know, the closest I could come was a back rub. Seriously, but I'm not sure, you know, then the person on the front row would be out of luck because the person on the back row was out of luck because there's no one to sort of massage and knead his or her soul shoulders. But anyway, this was Jesus' presentation of something that needs to be, we need to be reminded of. And even the foot washing urges re-presentation rather than just remembering. Washing his disciples' feet was not just a story about Jesus' humility and service. It foreshadowed the ultimate act of servanthood on the part of Jesus, which was indeed to be obedient to the Father, as we read last Sunday. To be obedient to the Father all the way to the point of death. By virtue of his service to his disciples and the service of his death, Jesus challenges conventional notions about leaders and followers. One person writes that it is no small wonder that the story of Jesus' betrayal immediately follows this scene of service. In other words, at least one person didn't enjoy the idea, the notion of serving, hence the betrayal. Now, while the Psalms were stands apart from these stories or instructions about specific events in the life of Israel and in the life of the church, the psalmist's gratitude is unmistakable. The psalmist presents again to believers of every age the present need for thanksgiving and for praise. You know, not unlike the Apostles' Creed, the Lord's Prayer, or the 23rd Psalm, there are lines in our lesson from 1 Corinthians that are so familiar that reading them almost seems superfluous, because most church members and attenders know at least some of those lines by heart. This evening, for a few minutes, I want us to focus on that first Maundy Thursday, that evening when Jesus gave his disciples a mandate to love one another. You know, when I was a boy, we went to a Presbyterian church. I mentioned that, I guess that was something else I presented downtown. I'm what Presbyterians like to call a cradle Presbyterian. It's not a boast. It's just a recognition of the fact that I was Presbyterian from the time Mama brought me home in a cradle. But I'm from Bristol, Virginia. You know, not completely rural, but not the most urban place in the whole wide world either. And in our Presbyterian church, we weren't liturgical at all. Well, we were in that we had liturgy, but none of it ever talked about the colors of the seasons. We never recognized the colors of the seasons, the holidays of the Christian year. To be sure, we recognized Easter and Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. But we didn't recognize any of those other things about the liturgical season, the Christian year. I remember going away to college, and the first time I went to the big First Presbyterian Church, you see, they sent a bus to our campus, and so you got a free ride. So everybody, not everybody, but a lot of people jumped on the bus and motored down the street to First Pres. And I sat down for that first worship service, which I guess was late August or early September, being my first day in school, as it were. And I looked at the bulletin, and it said, season, ordinary times, color, green. I had no clue what that meant. That blissful ignorance is now gone. I understand that stuff now. But I also remember later in the year that the church advertised a service called Maundy Thursday. I'd never heard that word in my life. To me, Maundy sounded kind of like a mood. It's kind of a Maundy service. I had no idea where the word came from. Now, the word comes from what we just read. The word comes from the Latin word for mandate. Jesus gave his disciples that night a mandate, which can also be translated command. And the command that night, what this whole service is about, is our remembering from Jesus' example to love one another. Jesus had already seen the sunset for his last time. Within about 15 hours, he would be nailed to a cross to die. Within 24 hours, he would be dead and buried, and he knew it. Surely Jesus at this time was somewhere between the ages of 30 and 35. Half the normal lifespan of one of his day and age. And Jesus was then and there at the very pinnacle of his ministry. At his age, most people still have their best and most productive years ahead of them. In that religious world, Muhammad was 60 when he was at the most productive in his life. Socrates, 70. Plato, 80. The Buddha, 80. If death threatens to cut short one's life or one's productivity, a sense of frustration typically sets in. People wondering, what in the world could he have done more? I mean, just read the internet and see what people are saying about, wonder what Steve Jobs will be introducing to the world of technology today, were he still alive. But not Jesus. And why, we should probably ask. Well, the answer is because he saw death as not an end to his mission, but as the fulfillment of his mission. In fact, it was probably only moments before he died that he could shout out with a loud voice, "It is finished!" He wasn't surrendering. He was acknowledging something. Another translation, maybe even a better translation of "it is finished," or the Greek word for that, might be "it has been paid in full." And contrary to a popular, mostly secular belief about this night and about this service and about this time in Jesus' life, although it was his last evening with his disciples, and although he had only a few more hours to live, Jesus looked forward to the completion of his mission. He looked ahead to the completion of his mission. He wasn't looking back on a failed attempt. It was the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Jesus and his disciples had planned to eat the Passover meal together. And the Bible says the place they met was a large upper room, furnished and ready. Evidently, no servant was present. And so the Lord himself undertook to do a menial task for and with his disciples, washing their feet. and then later at some time during their meal, the disciples must have watched captivated as Jesus took bread, gave thanks for it, passed it around, distributed it, and spoke those familiar words. And after the meal, he shared the cup and spoke more words with which we are familiar. Jesus was giving instructions for our commemoration, our celebration of his death. But he specifically told them and us about that meal to repeat it. It is significant that the only commemorative act instituted by Jesus himself dramatized neither his birth nor his life, but his death. Nothing could indicate more clearly that it was Jesus' death. It was his cross, which stands as central to our Christian faith. Jesus also referred to his blood as the new covenant associated with his blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. The writer to the Hebrews reminds us that there is no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood. In one of my classes in school over the past few years, I remember a conversation about what I used to call, still do I guess to a degree, blood songs. They sort of fell into disfavor with me. I don't know what was going on in my head or maybe even in my heart. But you know the blood songs about from Emmanuel's vein and there's power in the blood, you know. I was thinking, man, those are good old songs, I guess, but those are Baptist songs. Baloney. Shame on me. Shame on me for not becoming more in love again with the blood songs. We don't sing them as often as we should, and I think one of the reasons is because in our new book, there aren't a lot of them, because again, the writers of the new book probably felt like me. But there is no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood. God, in Jesus' death, took the initiative to establish that new covenant sealed in his blood. It was a covenant which was set into motion with his blood. Not the blood of a ram, not the blood of a bull, not the blood of a dove, not the blood of a goat. It was the blood of God's very own Son. Jesus died in order to bring us into a new covenant, contractual partnership relation with God. As this drama played out on that original Maundy Thursday, it was not an actor with 12 in an audience. Jesus involved his disciples, and he involves you and me as well. We, as they, are not spectators in the drama of the cross. We are participants, and we're reminded of that every single time we celebrate the Lord's Supper, communion, the Eucharist, whatever you want to call it. I've shared it with you before, and I'll share it with you again in one of the most important books I've ever read. I read the line by a Reformed person who said that although we Presbyterians don't believe that Jesus is on the table, we do believe that Jesus is at the table, serving as our host. And as long as the Lord gives me memory, I will remember that about communion. I will remember that about the table. It was not enough for Jesus only to die. We, as a result of his death, are faced with a choice. For Jesus' death to be central, it has to have purpose in our lives. We have to appropriate the death of Christ in our lives for it to be meaningful. This sacrament of the Lord's Supper was not instituted by Jesus as some sort of forget-me-not. It's the new Passover. We read the wonderfully intricate instructions in Exodus about the old Passover. The new Passover is similar in that it requires the blood. But you and I are now participants in the new Passover in no less a way than those families were participants in that Passover that we read about in Exodus. In the original Passover in Egypt, the Paschal Lamb died died in place of the firstborn of the family. And we read that earlier. Did you remember that the firstborn died, the firstborn human and animals, in the houses that did not have the blood applied to the doors? Even Israelite houses, if those people failed to follow the instructions, the angel of death did not pass over without doing his horrible, horrible duty in the houses of even God's own children, the Israelites. The Paschal Lamb, only if the Paschal Lamb had been slain, its blood applied and its flesh eaten, only then was the firstborn spared. Well, my sisters and brothers, tonight is all about how, for you and me, the Paschal Lamb has been slain. As a result, you and I are invited to this new Passover, furnished and prepared for us. And our invitation contemplates a commitment on our part, a commitment to serve Him who died in order that you and I might live. Thanks be to God. Amen. I want you to stand with me, and for our affirmation following the proclamation of God's word, we're going to involve in a litany, special litany for Maundy Thursday. Excuse me. It was the loneliest day of your life, Lord. Agendas of their own.
With only one exception, they all believed you were invincible.
So you all sat down around that table.
You broke the bread and said to them, "Take, eat, this is my body."
You took the cup and said, "Drink it, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins."
Then you said,
pray for Dottie and to pray for Oscar. to pray that unless the Lord has something really spectacular in mind, that the Lord go ahead and take Oscar sooner rather than later. Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, we thank you for this day. We've been waiting for this week for a long time, more than 40 days when we count the Sundays. This is, in fact, O Lord, Holy Week. It began on Sunday with a triumphant entry of Jesus into the city. And holy smokes, did they turn on him pretty doggone quickly. We remember tonight, O God, what Jesus did that night so long ago. And it's exciting to see the depictions of that night in the television programs that we see from time to time around this time of the year. To think of what Jesus did with those disciples, to think of what Jesus knew with respect to Judas, to think about those other disciples wondering, Lord, my goodness, is it I? Is it I? And the Lord, although it wasn't, all of us could say, yeah, it is I. To times in our lives when we have, as a matter of fact, betrayed the Lord Jesus Christ. And he died for that reason. He died for us who have, in fact, betrayed him and who will, in fact, continue to do so. Oh, Lord God, we thank you for what in Jesus Christ you have done for us. And as the psalmist, oh God, may we always offer praise and gratitude. Oh, Lord, when we eat this meal tonight, may we remember the first century version of it when Jesus offered it to his disciples. But may we also go back centuries and remember originally the Lord giving those directions to his people. We read those directions and we might think, my goodness, that's awfully picky. But, oh, Lord, I guess you were teaching them obedience. You were teaching them how to live a life that bespeaks one who is a follower of yourself. And then, oh Lord, I suspect in our heart of hearts, we who have forgotten important things from time to time might think, oh my gosh. And there must have been people who were awakened, perhaps to the screams of the firstborn. We don't get that completely, oh God. But then again, maybe we do. You are not a God with whom to be trifled, apparently. Apparently, oh God, this could be kind of scary. Apparently, at some point, your patience wears thin. Oh God, forgive us. Draw us back into a relationship with yourself. Oh God, we pray for the folks whose names were in our worship bulletin this past Sunday. For those folks on the list which has been prepared already for this Sunday. But to the top of our list, oh God, goes Oscar and Donnie's names. What precious people, oh God. And they loved this church and missed moving south to a distance away from us where they couldn't any longer be active participants in our church, but technically they're still members. Take care of Donnie, oh Lord, during this time. And gracious Lord Christ, if it be your will, and again, if you don't have something really spectacular in mind as the great physician, then take Oscar home to be with you sooner rather than later. Hear our prayers, O God, offered to you in the mighty name of Jesus and for his sake. Amen. Amen. As I mentioned in the brief meditation, these words that you're about to hear, you could probably just say them right along with Cassie and me. But that's not a bad thing. Spread before you and me is the feast of all of the people of God. People, especially on a night like this, on this very highly liturgical night, especially on a night like this, people will come from all over to enjoy this meal at table shared in fellowship with each other and in fellowship with the Lord God through the power and presence of his mighty Holy Spirit. This is the Lord's table. Anyone who places his or her faith and trust in Jesus as Savior and Lord is invited to this table. In our denomination, children who have been baptized and who are indeed in a process of learning their own personal profession of faith are invited to table. I understand that Kennedy is going to take communion for her first time tonight. Is that right?
Is she here?
Well, I don't know.
She is.
Okay.
Yes.
Is that the plan?
Yes.
So that's kind of cool. This is really a special night in Cassie and Matt's family. So children are invited as long as they are being instructed. And I know that little girl is being instructed in the ways of the Lord. I want to tell you that when we serve communion, we try to be inclusive. And if you need gluten-free bread, we have that. So just tell the server closest to you. And I want to tell you that when we serve the cup in our service of communion, the cup is in fact grape juice. We will serve in the pews tonight, and go ahead and take the bread and take the cup as soon as you are served. We don't have to wait until everybody is served. Nothing wrong with that, but that's just not our custom here at Burnstore. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe. You bring forth bread from the earth and create the fruit of the vine. You made us in your image and freed us from the bonds of slavery. You claimed us as your people and made covenant with us to be our God. You fed us manna in the wilderness and brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey. When we forgot you and our faith was weak, you spoke through prophets, calling us to turn again to your ways. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the celestial choirs and with all the faithful of every time and place. Together, we forever sing the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, whom you sent to deliver us from the bondage of death and slavery to sin. In humility, he descended from your heights to kneel in obedience to love's commands. He who is boundless takes on the bondage of our sin. He who is free takes our place in death's presence. In the deserts of our wanderings, he sustains us, giving us his body as manna for our weariness. The cup of suffering which he drank has become for us the cup of salvation. In his death, he ransomed us from death's dominion. In his resurrection, he opened the way to eternal life. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we take this bread and this cup from the gifts that you have given us, and celebrate with joy the redemption won for us in Jesus Christ. Accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, as a living and holy offering of ourselves, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ is God.
Your gifts of bread and cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and with all who are baptized in his name, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Lead us, O God, by the power of your Spirit to live as love commands. Bound to Christ, set us free for joyful obedience and glad service. As Jesus gave his life for ours, help us to live our lives for others with humility and persistent courage. Give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. Through Christ, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Church now and forever. And as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Once again, those words that you've heard, I think, on three different occasions tonight. Hear them for a fourth time. On the night that Jesus was arrested and betrayed, after giving thanks to the Father for it, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
There were several cups on the table, but then Jesus took a new cup. And after pouring, he said, "This cup represents the new covenant, which is sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of your sin. Drink of this in remembrance of me."
Because as long as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. Sisters and brothers, the gifts of God for the people of God. Amen. Pastor Cassie and I can be joined at table by those officers who will be assisting in the serving of communion.
Even
Jesus Christ, left us this holy meal of bread and cup, in which we share his body and blood. May we who have celebrated this sign of his great love show in our lives the fruits of his redemption. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You know, the Bible says before they left that upper room that was furnished and ready, they sang together a song. Let us stand together and sing a familiar one.
My riches gain I count.
Before the benediction, let me tell you that immediately following the benediction, we will have a brief little 2-minute and 45-second movie. Remember this as you watch the movie, as it comes to its conclusion. When in the Old Testament days that lamb was sacrificed, what was really clear when the knife was raised was that this lamb takes my place. Go in peace, serve the Lord, serve your neighbors, love each other. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Crucifying him.
Barabbas. They're crucifying the man who took your place.
I don't mean your place. I'm not saying you should be crucified.
Picking up. We need to go.
There is a hole in the wall between the cell. I can pull a piece out and see him. I saw everything.
Barabbas, the Romans may have let you go, but they aren't going to let you live.
They beat him. They cursed him. They spit on him.
He never said a thing.
He never fought back.
Once we get out of town and find someone to treat your wound.
Did you see what they did to him? His back. That crown. Those thorns.
At least it wasn't you.
Why not? Why not me? I am.
I don't know why not. But if we're going to leave, we need to leave now.
Stop! Stop talking! Just...
Jesus.
worked on the clutch, obviously, but there was something in the gearbox. It was, they said, a 50 quid. I'm not sure what 50 quid would be. A 50 quid piece. So, you know, I don't know how much a quid is. Apparently, it sounds like a good night, sir. Oh, good night. Oh, you're so sweet. Have a good evening. We'll see you Sunday.
You're going like this. I couldn't tell if you were going like this or.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Because
the lights
out.
I
should have popped the light on quick.
No, you were. Yeah, when you're down to one bar, you're looking at like an hour and 15 minutes.
Oh, okay. The Bells aren't playing tomorrow, are they?
They don't know.
Sunday, I think.
Oh, no, tomorrow's the racket stroke.
The racket strum.
Yeah, orchestra, racket strum. All right,
let's see what this is. So I heard you were playing music for people to bring their hips by.
What, they had like two or three people fall?
Yeah, right. It's the low end is so much that's not their shoulders.
Boy, Ken, you don't sound good.
I was getting so much better. I had like nothing left. And then all of a sudden,
oh, man.